Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. And welcome to the beautiful St. Dominic Chapel at Providence College for this very special centennial event with His Eminence Timothy Cardinal Dolan. I am Arthur Urbano, Professor of Theology and Chair of the Jewish-Catholic Theological Exchange Committee. And on behalf of that committee, I would like to extend a warm welcome to you all. I would also like to recognize a few of our honored guests, and I ask that you hold applause until I've mentioned all of them. First, the Most Reverend Robert Evans, Auxiliary Bishop for the Diocese of Providence, is here. Members of the Providence College Dominican community, members of the Board of Rabbis of Greater Rhode Island, members of the Providence College Board of Trustees, the faculty and seminarians of Our Lady of Providence Seminary, donors and friends, and a warm thanks as well to Mark Colazzi and the combined liturgical choirs for that beautiful musical prelude. Let's give them a round of applause. Tonight's talk is part of the Theological Exchange Between Catholics and Jews series. In 2009, the Theology Department established the lecture series as a forum for discussion and dialogue in the spirit of the Second Vatican Council's Nostra Aetate, a document that dramatically and positively reoriented Jewish-Catholic relations after centuries of tension, mistrust, and tragedy. In the words of Pope Francis, dialogue and friendship with the children of Israel are part of the life of Jesus' disciples. And over the past 50 years, Jews and Catholics have been engaged in honest and fruitful dialogue and have collaborated in theological and biblical study as well as social justice causes. Our series features local religious leaders as well as nationally recognized experts and brings together members of the Providence College community, local clergy, and members of the Greater Providence community for learning, collaboration, and friendship. This year marks the final of a three-year series commemorating the 50th anniversary of Nostra Aetate. We looked at Jewish-Christian relations prior to Vatican II, we studied the document and discussed its impact, and in this last year, we look ahead at the future of Jewish-Catholic dialogue. As you can imagine, a lot of work goes into planning these events, and I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge the commitment and efforts of my colleagues on the Jewish-Catholic Theological Exchange Committee. Would you join me in congratulating them and thanking them? These events are made possible by the generosity of our donors, alumni and friends of the college, Jews and Christians, committed to fostering mutual understanding, intellectual and spiritual engagement, and collaboration. If you would like more information about the program, or you would like to help us, there is a brochure hot off the presses in the pews with our website and contact information. Please take a copy home with you. And these brochures, by the way, are provided by the generosity of the graduate program in theology. Now please join me in welcoming Father Brian Shanley, President of Providence College, who will offer his greetings.
Thank you, Arthur, and I couldn't be more happy tonight to see this chapel filled for this event. As many of you know, we're celebrating our 100th birthday this year, and we've had lots of celebrations already and lots to come. But this one is truly special for our community because Providence College was founded 100 years ago to be a place of opportunity for people for whom education wasn't always an open door and an easy road to travel on. And we were founded primarily to educate the immigrant Catholic population that had come to Providence. But from our beginning as well, we have been a place of opportunity for Jewish students to come to Providence College. And tonight we celebrate that community that we have had since our founding with our Jewish brothers and sisters. And it is a special honor for us tonight to have Cardinal Dolan here with us, one of the preeminent players in the ongoing Jewish-Catholic dialogue. And I sat down this afternoon in the middle of a fairly busy day to reread Nostra Aetate, which is not a long document. And when you reread it, it's a little bit dated in some of its language, but what it fundamentally represents is the unity of the human family and the recognition amongst us that we are all children of God. And we are all in this chapel tonight, children of Abraham. And there is much more that binds us together than that divides us. And we need to learn how to talk about the things that still do divide us, but we also need to celebrate the things that unite us. And that's what we're here to do tonight. So thank you, Cardinal Dolan, for coming here tonight. And I also want to thank the committee. Arthur's a pretty humble guy, and he thanked his committee, but he's done more work than anybody to make tonight possible. So let's have a round of applause for Arthur. Thank you again for coming tonight. You honor us with your presence here. And I am not the main speaker tonight, so I'm going to stop right here and turn it back over to Arthur. Arthur.
Thank you, Father Shanley. As you can tell, Providence College takes pride in its connection to the Jewish community, a relationship that helps define the character of the institution over the course of its first century. It's in fact so important that it's the subject of a research project that a colleague of mine and I are currently working on, Dr. Jennifer Aluzzi in the History Department, in which we're studying the history of the admission and the experience of Jewish students to Providence College in its earliest decades. And Dr. Aluzzi and I will be giving a presentation and talk on this in the spring in March, and we're also producing a short documentary on the topic with the help of a film studies student here at Providence College. So please keep an eye out for that. It'll be very exciting. At the end of tonight's talk, there will be time for questions. I'm told there will be a microphone in the center aisle. It's not there now, but it will be. So please come to the mic at the center aisle when you're ready. And now it's an honor for me to introduce our speaker. His Eminence Timothy Cardinal Dolan has been Archbishop of New York since 2009. He was ordained to the priesthood in 1976 and served in parish ministry in Missouri. He earned a doctorate in church history from the Catholic University of America and has held teaching positions in that area, including at the Pontifical Gregorian University and the Pontifical University of St. Thomas Aquinas in Rome. He also served as rector of the Pontifical North American College in Rome from 1994 to 2001. In 2012, he was appointed to the College of Cardinals by Pope Benedict XVI and participated in the conclave that elected His Holiness Pope Francis. And among his many positions in the church today, the one that we acknowledge and celebrate today especially is his role as co-chair at the National Catholic Jewish Dialogue, which is a working consultation for dialogue between the U.S. bishops and the National Council of Synagogues. When we started this humble program several years ago, I couldn't imagine myself saying these words. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce to you His Eminence Timothy Cardinal Dolan.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, Arthur, for that gracious introduction. Bishop Evans and Father Shanley, Dr. Urbano, and my brothers in the ministry, dear priests and rabbis, consecrated religious women and men, the faculty of this prestigious university, our Jewish guests and friends, one and all. Thank you. Thank you very much for your gracious invitation and your warm welcome. Look at this crowd. I don't know about our Jewish friends, but we Catholics would call this a two-collection crowd. This is great. Father Shanley's already up. As one who has benefited personally from Dominican wisdom in my own priestly formation, and as a pastor who is now blessed in New York to have the vigorous presence of Dominican sisters, brothers, and priests, my time with you this evening on this beautiful Dominican campus is a gift that I savor very, very much. Now look, everybody, let's get one thing straight. You got to believe me that I am far from an expert in the blessed enterprise of the Jewish-Catholic dialogue we all now relish, an enterprise that has been so enhanced by this university and this lecture series. I sure enjoy our interreligious efforts. I certainly take them seriously, and I've been heavily involved in them, both as Archbishop of Milwaukee and now of New York. Dr. Urbano mentioned, my work as co-chair of the National Jewish Catholic Dialogue would be an especially privileged moment, and I'm so glad that Rabbi Wayne Franklin, who serves in that dialogue as well, is with me this evening. My friendship with the Jewish community in New York is especially exhilarating. I can't take credit for it. My predecessors set it up. In fact, all New Yorkers love telling the story about Francis Cardinal Spellman, one of my predecessors, who was well known for his business and real estate acumen. Early on, right after Nostra Aetate, Rabbi Mark Tannenbaum, the renowned Jewish leader in New York, invited Cardinal Spellman to his synagogue to speak, which was thought of as a very revolutionary occasion. And Rabbi Tannenbaum said, "Your Eminence, Cardinal Spellman, you are very welcome." And he said, "There's one thing I can't figure out." He said, "You are wearing a red yarmulke, and your congregation's in the black. I'm wearing a black one, and mine's in the red, all right?" If I have any proficiency in this field, it has come from the School of Hard Knocks, not from any academic training. Our gathering this evening, folks, on this feast of a Dominican saint, Martin de Porres, is particularly providential as we're still basking in last year's golden jubilee of that inspired document Father Shanley spoke of, that document of the Second Vatican Council, Nostra Aetate, a teaching that dramatically transformed Jewish-Catholic relations, thanks be to God. We Catholics sometimes quip that our Jewish neighbors pay a lot more attention to Vatican statements than we do, but both of us, thank God, have paid immense attention to Nostra Aetate, and I would maintain, because of it, our friendship, it has never been better. Now, the pontiff, the pope, for over 50% of the 51 years since that inspired document, was Pope, now Saint, John Paul II, for whom the worldwide Jewish community has a deep reverence. I worked on this talk 11 days ago on October 22nd. That was his feast day. And what I'd like to do for the next 40 minutes or so is to focus on his monumental role in bringing Nostra Aetate to fruition. 4 months after his death, in April of 2005, I had the privilege of traveling with four other bishops from the United States and about a half dozen rabbis on a very moving trip to Israel, Poland, and Rome. In the Eternal City, we were running late, and our guide announced that, because we were going to be tardy for our appointment at the synagogue of Rome, we would have to skip our prayer at the tomb of John Paul II. "The hell we are," and I quote, protested the six rabbis. And to stand before his tomb in St. Peter's Basilica, bishops and rabbis, hands joined, eyes moistened, was a pinnacle of our pilgrimage. Now, look, what immediately comes to mind when we consider John Paul II and his friendship with the Jews would be two things. One would be the theological advances, in Jewish-Catholic understanding. And two would be the candid dialogue over the neuralgic issues that arose during his 26 and a half year pontificate. This prestigious locus of Jewish-Catholic dialogue, Providence College, would be well aware of the first, John Paul's theological invitation that we Jews and Christians would now return to the conversation that had been rudely interrupted in 70 AD when Roman soldiers leveled Jerusalem, scattering both Jews and Christians in a diaspora that is still with us, and take up again such profound questions as covenant, election, Israel's special and unique place in God's revelation, the law, and how the two of us are to relate as children of Abraham and people of the book. The acceptance of that invitation from John Paul has resulted in a promising flourishing of Jewish Catholic scholarship, the event this evening, only one such example. Likewise, are we all cognizant of those retroactive issues that the Polish Pope never dodged. Tender topics, remember, such as those Good Friday prayers, the somber and tragic legacy of Christian anti-Semitism, the role of the Holy See during the Shoah, Vatican diplomatic recognition of the State of Israel, or even flashy episodes like the proposed cross and convent at Auschwitz, the movie The Passion of the Christ, and the visit of Kurt Waldheim to the Vatican. Instead of elaborating on those two admittedly worthwhile areas, I would dare suggest to you this evening that Pope John Paul II realized the dream of Nostra Aetate in a much more substantive and innovative way, namely, by trusting the Jewish community enough to invite them into what was indeed the number one priority of his pontificate, to recover the primacy of the spiritual. To recover the primacy of the spiritual. Simply put, everybody, John Paul II believed that the most mortal toxin infecting the human project was the denial of God's sovereignty, the denial even of his existence, and that the church's most natural ally in facing this challenge were the Jews. Humanity's preference of late to get along just fine without God, to use Rabbi Jonathan Sacks's definition of secularism, was deadly and must be reversed. The Pope believed that the Jewish community would share his sense of urgency. Let me try to explain. See, John Paul II took literally the dictum of the Hebrew psalmist that only in God is my soul at rest. And that, as our common scriptures reveal unremittingly, any attempt to seek absolute peace, meaning, or purpose in anyone or anything else besides the one true God was a recipe for chaos and frustration. It was Billy Graham who would observe that the revival of humanity's empty and exhausted soul became John Paul's primary mission. And this pontiff was convinced that our elder brothers and sisters, as he called the Jewish community, were among our most valued partners in this endeavor. He came upon this drive to recover the primacy of the spiritual very naturally. The high-octane Catholicism of his beloved Poland saw God's design and presence everywhere. Poland's own tragic history had taught the young Karol Wojtyla that faith alone would never fail, even when all else did, as it had. His Poland had literally been erased from maps in the 19th century, and while its status may have been restored after World War I, it was left in the dirt. So young Karavoitia turned to the Hebrew Psalms. Whoever trusts in God is like Mount Zion, unshakable, it stands forever. He himself had lost everything, his mother, his sister, his brother, a physician who succumbed to an epidemic in Krakow while treating others, and his father by the time he was in his early 20s. With the rest of Poland, he described how he cried as he watched the Luftwaffe swarm over his country on September 1st, 1939, and lived in daily peril for six bleak years, watching Jewish friends and his own classmates in the secret seminary in the basement of the Cardinal Archbishop's house disappear nightly. In fact, early one morning, coming home from work in the chemical factory in the suburbs of Krakow on a very frozen night, he himself was hit by a truckload of drunken Nazi soldiers and left for dead on the side of the road. Things didn't get better in 1945, did they? As Poland lost the world twice, when the jackboots of Hitler's thugs were replaced by those of Stalin's, as the climate of enforced, oppressive living without God continued to smother Poland. What got the people of Poland through? The faith of Jewish and Christian wisdom. Only in God is my soul at rest. Is it any wonder why his first words on the balcony of St. Peter's were those repeated so often by the God of Israel and by his son Jesus, be not afraid. Now here's the most radiant illustration of John Paul's strategy to recover the primacy of faith. Coming during what has been called those 9 days that changed the world, when he returned to Poland at the beginning of June 1979, remember? Henry Kissinger would claim he then did for Poland what Churchill had done for England. Mikhail Gorbachev would later conclude that those 9 days were the beginning of the end of communist hegemony, a hammer and sickle which had especially been used against Catholics and Jews. On the final day of that historic visit, in Victory Square in Warsaw, before 2 million Poles, he began to deliver at Mass what all somberly felt would probably be his last public address ever in his homeland. He had only spoken a few moments when the three-word chant began. It started in a corner and soon tsunamied over the throng as 2 million Poles shouted the same three words. What were those three words? Down with communism? Uh-uh. Russia go home? Nope. The three words were, we want God. We want God. It went on for 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. We want God. His nervous Monsignor attendant whispered, Holy Father, perhaps you might want to hush the crowd so you can finish your sermon, only to have John Paul look at him and smile as if to say, are you crazy? This is why I came. We want God. The primitive cry of faith, of belief, of humanity's innate longing for the divine, a thirst denied, ignored, ridiculed, outlawed, and reasoned away for too long by the lies of a society and culture that had vainly sought purpose in systems and mentalities that forgot God. It was as if John Paul's visit to his beloved homeland had put on the lips of his people the pining of the Hebrew psalmist, like a deer that thirsts for living water, so my soul longs for you, my God. The twisted, distorted cross of Nazism was straightened out. The hammer and sickle of Lenin and Stalin became a plowshare. We want God. That, of course, my friends, is the quintessential cry of Israel. And John Paul II saw today's children of Abraham, Isaac, Joseph, Moses, David, and the prophets as essential to the recovery of the primacy of the divine in a world drugged to forget the Lord. John Henry Newman had worried a century prior to that shout in Warsaw that we now live in a world that is simply irreligious. The leading peritus on the life of John Paul II, George Weigel, tells us that the Pope looked right into the eyes of this deformation of the great humanistic project in which the God of the Hebrew and Christian Bible came to be regarded as the enemy of human maturation and liberation, and did not blink, observes Weigel. In the pervasive worldview of atheistic humanism, secularism, created by such thinkers as Comte, Feuerbach, Marx, and Nietzsche, biblical religion was the enemy, for it impeded the progress of humanity. Thus, moderns must free themselves from the constraints of faith, that it might march boldly into a bright, humane future, freed from those shackles imposed on it by the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. No wonder Solzhenitsyn could conclude that the horrors of World War I and II could have only happened because humanity had forgotten God. John Paul's cause then was to rally Christians and Jews together to shout out, "We want God." For what had been squandered was a sense of awe at the very mystery of God, a mystery at the soul of Judaism and Christianity. Our visions had been blotted. Skepticism and cynicism dominate our discourse. All is at the mercy of manipulation by our self-willfulness, and the pleasure principle has ended up robbing us of joy. Man had become a puzzle for technicians to solve instead of a mystery for poets to love and embrace. Nostra Aetate tells us that all peoples comprise a single community and have a single origin. One also is their final goal, Almighty God. His providence, His goodness, His saving designs extend to all. A couple of years ago, I was honored to host at my house behind St. Patrick's Cathedral the chief rabbi of Rome, Riccardo Di Segni, for lunch. He was so excited as he shared with me what was then a secret, the intentions of Pope Francis to visit the synagogue in Rome, as Pope Benedict and Pope John Paul II had. He tenderly recalled the visit of John Paul to the synagogue in 1986 when the Pope called Jews and Christians to a, quote, collaboration in favor of humanity. For Jews and Christians, our belief in God has certain implications, which John Paul believed impel Jews and Christians to work together. This is indeed a collaboration in favor of humanity. One such implication would be our insistence on the dignity of the human person, created according to Genesis in God's very image and likeness, made, so says the psalmist, little less than a god. Two would be the sanctity of every human life, never a means to an end, but an end in itself. A third is a trust in reason as an ally to faith, a theme that would be taken up vigorously by John Paul's successor, Benedict XVI. You see, both Jews and Catholics see faith and reason as friends, not enemies. If mind and soul are not in harmony, our two traditions agree, we risk either the dictatorship of relativism on the side of narcissistic rationalism, or a bloody fundamentalism at the other extreme of superstitious fetishism. Four would be an allegiance to God's law, truths, as John Paul commented at Mount Sinai, written on the human heart before being engraved in stone, not to be contradicted by self-will or popular demand. Five would be solidarity, a sense that we're all in this together, and that we're much better off sticking together and looking out for each other than we are locked up in our own comfort zones. Sixth would be the conviction that faith, while deeply personal, is never private. Our interior convictions, Jews and Catholics hold, have social, public implications. Our religion is not confined to the sanctuary of the parish or the bima of the synagogue, but spills out to the public square. This is a theme dramatically, indefatigably trumpeted by Pope Francis, who sees the implications of our Judeo-Christian ethic in our outreach to the poor, the refugee, the protection of the environment, just to name a few. The seventh implication of our working together would be a mutual worldview. You see, Jews and Catholics share the same glasses. Simply put, history is his story for a Christian or a Jew. The history of salvation, in which Jews and Christians believe, is in fact the history of the world. Both John Paul II and Rabbi Joshua Heschel would remind us that coincidence is the term that non-believers employ instead of providence, a term I use joyfully on this campus. And like Heschel, evident... Oh, thanks. Do you have an olive to put in it? No, that won't be. Afterwards, all right? And like Heschel, everybody, evident in the title of his great book, John Paul II was convinced that the human story is not so much the recounting of our search for God, but of God's search for us. So, Pope John Paul II would become a pilgrim like Abraham, reminding the world of its real story, its genuine identity as God's creation, unfolding according to his plan and providence, the story of Abraham, Moses, David, and Jesus. This optic, common to Jews and Christians, makes us, as John Paul commented often, a blessing to one another. Together we share our eyeglasses with others so that all can see history to be his story, that human dignity and life are enhanced, not shackled, when we proclaim we want God, that each of us is called to renew the Exodus, allowing the Lord to free us from slavery and death to freedom and life as we celebrate every Passover and Easter. It was Theodore Herzl a century ago who understood that anti-Semitism is proof that something is seriously flawed in the culture of the West. George Weigel again. When the fever chant of anti-Semitism spikes upward, it's always the sign that the patient is in mortal danger. in no small part because it has forgotten the biblical roots of the Western civilizational enterprise. For the foundational Western metaphor of freedom and human liberation is not the Enlightenment, but the Exodus. And the Exodus is a liberation completed by a moral code intended to help the free rid themselves of the habits of slaves, the bad habits that derive from willfulness and self-absorption. Aleo Toaf, who was chief rabbi of Rome when John Paul visited the synagogue on the Tiber River, died a couple years ago, remember? Pope John Paul II, did you know this? Pope John Paul II mentioned only two men in his brief last will and testament. He thanked his loyal priest secretary, Stanislaw Jivich, and he thanked Rabbi Aleo Toaf. No wonder. Karol Wojtyla and Aleo Toaf, a Catholic and a Jew, were two men who sensed the groans of their century in their guts, and who believed that only by placing God first and entrusting and respecting one another can we get back on the path to God instead of remaining a dead-end road of forgetting or denying Him. Our project of together asking those deep theological questions of election, covenant, revelation, messianic hope, divine promise, and redemption, scholarly questions Jews and Christians now both probe together, are effacing those social and cultural challenges we confront, such as ominous anti-Semitism or systematic persecution of Christians, all start with our mutual chant, so innate in the fiber of Jews and Christians, we want God. We need God. Dominant cultural attempts to sideline Him, reject Him, deny Him, ignore Him, run from Him, or mock Him only lead to trouble. In this era, when faith is being reduced to an innocuous hobby or superstition at best, to a cause of bigotry, backwardness, and violence at worst, to confess we want God is nothing less than prophetic. So that's my plug this evening, everybody, that Nostra Aetate inspired John Paul II to not just tolerate Jews, not just have theological discussions with them, not just meet with them at times of controversy and neuralgia, as essential as all those were, but to invite them into a providential and urgent partnership flowing from mutual faith, love, and biblical roots, where Jews became like their prophets of old, and Catholics like the 12 apostles and the towering saints in calling the world away from the worship of false idols into the arms of the one true eternal God who personally and passionately loves us, who has a plan for us, in whom alone we find purpose and peace, and whose providence is sovereign. When I was a boy in fourth grade at Holy Infant Grade School in Baldwin, Missouri, we had as a project to memorize the Ten Commandments. Not a bad project, by the way. The pastor would be in the next day to quiz us. I knew him by heart, or so I thought, until Father Callahan called on me in class to recite them. I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt not have strange gods before me. Boy, I started fine, like the Cleveland Indians. But then, I started fine, but then went blank. Was I ever relieved moved when the pastor said, "Well, Tim, that's the most important one. All the others flow from that one." John Paul II would agree. Jews, I think, would agree. Catholics certainly would. And Nostra Aetate, 51 years old, just a baby to a Jew or a Christian, would agree and urge us to work together to teach it to a world which now sadly tends to go hoarse when inspired to shout, "We want God." Thank you. Thanks. Thanks. Thank you. Thanks. Wow. Boy. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Boy, thanks. A lot better reaction than last week's Al Smith dinner, I'll tell you that. Wow. Oh, man. Art, do you want to kind of come moderate this question and answer? Okay. And call security in, all right?
Thank you, Cardinal Dolan. Thank you very much. So our microphone is here in the center aisle. If anyone has questions, Cardinal's willing to take some questions and answer them for you. So.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Welcome. It's wonderful to have you with us. I'm so glad you mentioned the dinner, because we'd like a few tidbits if you want to give them before you leave. It was an extraordinary situation, and you handled it so gracefully. I'm thinking back to when the Pope went to the Holy Land and his dramatic visit, Pope Francis, the tremendous love that we felt here in the United States, and when he stopped at the wall and the Wailing Wall, et cetera. And I know he invited folks back to the Vatican for more discussions. I'm just wondering if there's anything else that you could kind of shed light on into the Vatican and trying to bring peace to that troubled region.
I am very glad you mentioned Pope Francis. My concentration on Pope St. John Paul II in no way is meant to downplay the role that Pope Benedict and now our beloved Pope Francis have had in the implementation of Nostra Aetate and in the fruition of Jewish-Catholic dialogue. It's interesting, I've often written and remarked that John Paul II had a drive and a passion for the soul. And I just spoke to you about that, the recovery of the primacy of the spiritual. Benedict had it for the mind, didn't he, for the intellect. And now our beloved Pope Francis has it for the heart. So he's putting a heart, not that the other two pontiffs didn't, but he's emphasizing the heart at the role of this. And the occasions that you mentioned, touching gestures early on in his pontificate and inviting the president of Israel and the president of the Palestinian Authority, the friendship, the deep and abiding friendship that he enjoyed with the Jewish community in Buenos Aires when he was archbishop there, would all give evidence of the role of the heart and the role of affection. This is interesting now. I had a very enlightening conversation beforehand over at the enjoyable reception. And some of us, I was with some of my Jewish friends, and they were commenting that it's all, and they're veterans in the Jewish-Catholic dialogue, Wayne was among them, they were saying that it's almost like the Jewish-Catholic dialogue had kind of moved from neuralgia to theology and is now into love and affection. Now there's friendship. Now there's conversation. I had recounted how at home in New York, one of the most vibrant illustrations of Jewish-Catholic dialogue is not among priests and rabbis. It's not hosted by a university. It's a, Jews and Catholic lay people coming together at each other's homes to discuss issues of common concern. That's the heart, isn't it? That's the discovery of love and affection and warmth and tenderness that I think is now characteristic of the process of Nostra Aetate. And I think you're onto something when you would cite Pope Francis as kindling that the role of the heart there.
To what degree are the ideas presented in Nostra Aetate have become part of teaching in Catholic schools, Sunday schools, and so on? What kind of changes were made in instruction as a result of Nostra Aetate?
I think a lot, but I think not enough. I think a lot, but not enough. I say that because as Archbishop of New York, I deal with a lot of publishers in New York and some of our catechetical publishers who will often ask me to give the imprimatur, you know, with that's the permission to be published and to testify that the work is free from any doctrinal error. And I will often say to them, I think we need a little spicing up in this section or that section, because these can be areas of misunderstanding in the past when it comes to our Jewish neighbors. You're perhaps familiar, Rabbi Franklin and I are, of the great efforts that have been made to bring Catholic school teachers and catechists together for a week-long series precisely to meet the challenge that the rabbi just mentioned. Of how to teach our children a respect for the Jewish faithful, and how to make them more sensitive to the tragic history of anti-Semitism. And actually in the Archdiocese, thanks to grants from Jews and Catholics, our Catholic school teachers during their vacation receive a grant to go to school for a week to learn this. Every year, and I know there's a lot of this that goes on, every year I'm invited to a Seder supper where the 7th and 8th graders from Epiphany Catholic Grade School are meeting with the 7th and 8th graders of one of the shuls in New York. And to hear those, there'd be Jewish and Catholic kids in each group, and to hear them speak about the common symbols that they would detect in the Seder and our Mass, our Eucharist, is stunning to see how those children are attentive to it. Those are things to celebrate, everybody, not forgetting the more advanced work that goes on, like at a Catholic institution of this prestige. I don't think, Brian, there would be any Catholic university now, I hope not, that would not have some type of theological, philosophical collaboration on Jewish-Catholic issues. I think I'm rather secure in saying that. And so a lot's happened, but I don't think enough. This is interesting, and again, we were talking beforehand. What we Jews and Catholics do not want to happen is that we would become victims of our own success. The good news is that the Jewish-Catholic friendship in the United States has never been stronger. The bad news is that the Jewish-Catholic friendship in the United States has never been stronger. Why? Because we're tempted to take it for granted, all right? We're tempted to become ho-hum about it. And boy, we can never let that happen, see? So, fellas, what do you have at the seminary? Do you have, would you benefit from some of the courses here? Good. Boy, Father Maher's breathing a sigh of relief that you came through with that answer. Way to go. Please, ma'am.
Hi, can you comment on whether the church has had an official reaction?
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Can you comment on whether the church has had an official reaction to the recent resolution of UNESCO, UNESCO's resolution on the Temple Mount?
Well, I don't want to let the cat out of the bag, and Wayne, I don't know if you know this or not, but we've put that, the two co-chairs have put that on the agenda for our meeting on Monday, because we feel strongly we should say something. You know this delicate question we're talking about, that UNESCO has said, is it the temple and the wall, Rabbi Franklin, can no longer be considered a Jewish religious site. It's simply historical and cultural. Our Jewish friends here tonight can comment much more eloquently than I could, but that's nothing less than patronizing, insulting, and inaccurate, okay? Now, two religious groups who have been treated with less than dignity by the United Nations would be Jews and Catholics. So this could bring us together on that one.
Like you said before, Nostra Aetate is still very young, but what do you see or hope for the future of Christian and Jewish relations?
Well, you know what? What a great question. Here's what we also have to remember, folks. Father Shanley was right. Nostra Aetate is a very crisp, succinct document. As short as it is, only a page and a half is about Catholic-Jewish relations. Also in Nostra Aetate would be Islamic Christian relations and the Eastern religions and their relationship with the church. I think now, and again, this has a good and a bad side. What's happened now is that because the Jewish-Catholic dialogue is so durable, I think many Catholic leaders are now concentrating on an Islamic Catholic dialogue. Not bad, as long as we don't forget the first, and not bad because you can't have that without bringing in the Jews, especially given the violent fundamentalist hatred of Israel and the Jewish race. That would have to be part of our dialogue. So in a way, you ask a keen question about the future of Nostra Aetate. I can't speak for the Holy Father. I can't speak for the Secretariat for Relations Between Catholics and Jews. But I think what I detect among some Catholic leaders is, we're doing pretty good on this one. We got to keep at it. But now maybe we can also put some of our effort and energy into our relationship with Islam and our relationship with the Eastern religions. Make sense? What do you think, Dr. Urbano? What part of Ireland did your people come from? The lunch menu would always be one, right? All right. I think, and Dr. Franklin, Rabbi Franklin might want to comment too. I've been in this since 2002, all right? So 14 years. How long you been in it, Wayne? That long? Okay. At the beginning, it was really neuralgic. The first meeting of the National Jewish-Catholic Dialogue that began right after Nostra Aetate, and is extraordinarily warm and productive, the first meeting I went to in November of 2002 was right after Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ had come out. You talk about a shouting match, all right? And I remember at the break going to freshen up with the Catholic co-chair of the time, Cardinal William Keeler, the Archbishop Emeritus of Baltimore. And I said to him, Eminence, what this, all this arguing? I said, my God, if I wanted this type of arguing, well, I'm going to have it with my family at Thanksgiving. I didn't need to come here. He said, but that's the point. He said, we come together around the table, and we do have our arguments because we love the dialogue, and we feel so passionate about it that we don't want anything to destroy it. Now, my point in bringing that up 14 years ago is that things have developed, and now, now we find ourselves moving on to theological issues. And what I think Rabbi Franklin and I would describe as ongoing formation. We're friends enough now that the Jewish collaborators can say, you know what? We don't understand all these divisions in Christianity, the Orthodox, the Protestants, the Catholics. You keep talking about these ancient Eastern rites in the Mideast, and we don't understand them. Of course, we Catholics said we don't either, but could we have a session on that, Dr. Urbano? And we did, didn't we? Then we said, while you're at it, thanks for bringing that up. We don't understand Reform, Orthodox, Hasidics. Could you help? And they said, neither do we. And they said, could you help us understand that? That would be examples of what I call ongoing formation that now we're doing. Number two, what you'd see now developing is a high interest in pastoral issues. So when I talk to Dr. Franklin, you know what he'll talk to me about? We're losing our young people. What intermarriage does, good and bad. The divisions that we have in worship and liturgy. What secularism is doing. The fact that the Pew Research Center, you think we got problems? So do they. In the rise of the nuns. That inherited religions, we can no longer depend on families passing them on. Those are, when he says that, I'm thinking, wow, we got those same problems. I was invited a couple months ago to the Shabbat service at one of our temples in New York, and during the Shabbat service was a bar mitzvah as a part of it. And afterwards, when I was visiting with the rabbi, I said, how powerful that is, and how enduring that will be in that young man's life, this bar mitzvah. And the rabbi said to me, odds are the next time I'll see that young man is in 25 years when he brings his son in for bar mitzvah. And I said, oh, we call that confirmation. You see, the same pastoral problems. Do you realize how Jews and Catholics are so close? We are both inherited religions. We are both liturgical religions. We are both feast day religions. We are both seasonal holidays and holy days. We both have dietary and penitential expectations, all right? We both have a coherent culture that is rapidly disintegrating, okay? We got a lot of pastoral issues in common. And thirdly, the third thing we forever talk about is the situation in the Middle East, especially in Israel, because that's a tense topic for us. Now, folks, hear me say this. In our combat of systematic genocide against Christians throughout the world, we have no stronger allies than the American Jewish community. They will constantly come to see me, and they'll say, Cardinal Dolan, you Catholics got to speak up more. We've been through this. It won't go away. It will only get worse. Listen to us, and we will help you organize to stop anti-Christian persecution. Those are issues that we frequently speak about. We all right? I got to get back to New York. Thank you. Did you want to thank and praise me?
I do, absolutely.
Well, thank you so much, Cardinal Dolan, for mapping out for us the importance of the Jewish-Christian relationship, how we can be a blessing to one another, and the work that still needs to be done, and the work that we're doing. And thank you to all of you for coming here this evening. There's a liveliness to the Jewish-Christian relationship here in Providence and Rhode Island that we can continue to foster. And I'd like to invite all of you downstairs to a wonderful dessert reception.
Oh. On second thought, I got time.
He's going to stay a little longer.
Invite me to a basketball game, will you?
Okay, we can get you free tickets, right?
When do you play Fordham? We have to work, Rabbi, on the Dominican Jesuit dialogue. That is, you talk about it.
So our reception is downstairs in the chapel, and also downstairs there's an email list. If you would like more information about future events, please sign up, and don't forget to take one of our beautiful brochures. Thank you again, everyone, and God bless.